Hey guys! Welcome to Life Church Online. We are so glad to have you join us here today. One of the opportunities we offer here at Life Church is our Growth Track class. We design Growth Track with you in mind to help you in your journey with God.
Another opportunity we offer you here is a small group discussions. This is a chance for you to meet new people at Life Church and get connected.
If you'd like to know more about these classes or know more about Life Church in general, please send us a message on Facebook.
If you would like to get our latest updates, like us on Facebook and follow us on Instagram. Thank you for joining us here today.
And we hope you enjoyed today's service.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Life Church Online. We are so glad that you have joined us today. And today we're going to continue our sermon series topic, the letter of James. And we're going to go into the chapter 3 of James and just kind of cover a very interesting topic, one of those topics that you don't want to talk about, but you have to talk about because it's what James talked about. And of course, James is one of those guys, he really doesn't just beat around the bush about how he talks. He just comes out and says it, and that's what he's talking about today. It's the power of the tongue, or how to control our tongue, or taming the tongue. And I think it's so important that we do this. In fact, I think the scriptures bears out that if we will be people that can control our tongue, then we can really see wonderful things in our life. Because oftentimes most of our problems happen because we talk more than we listen. And I want to start with James chapter 1, because in our reading several weeks ago, we read over this, and then we're coming back to this in chapter 3. So James chapter 1, verse 26 says this: "If you claim to be religious but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself, and your religion is worthless." And I just want to confess today that I don't have a total grip on all of this yet. I've had my own challenges with this whole tongue thing, because, you know, it seems like it's in the times where people may do you the wrong way, or they may say something, or even family members that are close to you, and then you come back with something that you want to say to validate yourself and say, well, I'm right, they say they're right, and then it becomes this big argument. And it's so important that we learn how to control our tongue, because this is really how we prove that we are religious, that we are truly what God wants us to be, to keep ourselves unspotted from the world, to keep ourselves from these things that are not right in our world. And this is one of the greatest ways that we can show that, by controlling our tongue and taming our tongue. So I want to read through this chapter and talk about this idea today. What we need to understand today is what I say will determine the direction of my life. You know, in the Bible, there was the leader Moses over all the children of Israel. He sent out some spies to do a reconnaissance mission. And he said, I want you to go and I want you to spy out the land and come back with a report and let us know what you think about the territory and how we can take the land. And when the spies came back with their report, 10 of them came back with a negative report and 2 of them came back with a good report. The 10 spies came back and they said, the people in that land are stronger than we are. And they even compared themselves to looking like grasshoppers in their sight. So they had this grasshopper mentality. They saw themselves as weak and unable to accomplish the mission that God called them to. But then there were 2 men named Joshua and Caleb, and they were the only 2 men that stood up in front of the people and said, we are well able to take this land. They spoke words of confidence, and I just want to encourage us today that God wants us to have that kind of courage and that kind of heart, to where we speak words that are encouraging, words that believe, words that see beyond what we're actually seeing. And so controlling our tongue, taming our tongue, is one of the hardest things that we will find in life. In fact, the Bible says in James chapter 3, verse 3 through 4, it says, we can control very large horses and put small bits into their mouths. By controlling their mouth, we can turn the whole animal whatever direction we want it to go. Or take ships as an example. A tiny rudder makes a large ship turn wherever the pilot wants it to go, even though the winds are strong. And so here he's talking about how he relates a bit in the horse's mouth to how that horse will go, the direction that that horse will go. When I was a teenager growing up, I had a horse, and I learned how to put a bit in the horse's mouth and how to control that horse. The direction is affected by what we say. Where we go is going to be directly influenced by the words that we're speaking. In fact, when these spies came back and they brought this negative report, these 10 spies actually influenced the whole of Israel. And those who believed that report, they believed that negative confession, the scripture says that whole generation had to die off before they could go in and conquer the land that they went in to spy out. And the only people that actually went in to conquer that land were the new generation and Joshua and Caleb. Joshua and Caleb outlived all of their contemporaries. In fact, they also went on to do great exploits in their life because they had this confidence that came from their mouth, and they spoke words and confessions that they were able to conquer. And I want to tell you, it's important that we declare God's word in our life, that we declare the things that we are not necessarily seeing, but what we believe. So what we say will have a determining factor on our direction. And then number two, what I say can destroy what I have. Now let's look at this. In James chapter 3, verses 5 through 6 says, "Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell." And so recently there was an example of this in California. There was some California wildfires that took place, and there were about 1 million acres of fire that burned forest to the ground. They started doing an investigation on where did this happen and how did this start, and they came back to one person that was setting up his tent out in the forest, and he simply was taking a stake, hitting the hammer with the stake, and sparks began to fly. In 1 second, that spark flew and caused it to light up brush there nearby, and thus the fire burned down an entire 1 million acres of land. I just want to say today that even the small sparks that come flying out of our mouth, the words that we speak from our mouth, will have an effect on the people around us. It will have an effect on our life. It will have an effect on the things that are going on around our life. So we have to be careful that we not let our words, the sparks that are flying out of our mouth, destroy the life that God has given us, because our words can and will destroy relationships. They will destroy lots of good things that God has placed in our life. So Proverbs chapter 10 verse 19 says it like this. It says, "Too much talk leads to sin, but be sensible and keep your mouth shut." So that's pretty good advice. So where there is a lot of talk, there is sin. Another translation says. So you probably heard this. God's given us 2 ears and 1 mouth because he wants us to listen more than we speak. Because if we will learn to listen instead of speak so much, then God can begin to use us and he can bless our life. And we will be less able to make mistakes and sin with our tongue. And so number three, what I say is what reveals what's really in my heart. So it goes back to the heart. You know, James 3 verses 9 through 10 says it like this. "With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father. With it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursings. My brothers and sisters, this should not be." So he's talking here about how that we say one thing, and then when everything's good, we're saying good things. But when things are not good, we're speaking negative things and bad things. So let's go on. In James chapter 3, verses 11 and 12 says, "Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water." So this is what he's saying, that there's something that's happening in our life and it has to come from the heart of the matter. The spring, there's a source of the spring. And where is the source of our words coming from? It's coming from our heart. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so what we are saying is coming from our heart. So we got to get our heart in alignment with God so that we're not living a lie, that we're not speaking words that are going to discourage and cause people to feel like they're worthless, but we're going to encourage one another. We're going to lift one another up. Matthew 12, 24 says, Jesus was very straightforward with the Pharisees when he said this. He said, "You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say any good? For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of." Whatever's in your heart is going to come out through your speech. And so what are you putting in your life? What are you watching? What are you Where are your eyes going on the internet? What are we allowing to listen to in music? All of these things affect how we will speak, the words that we say. And I want to encourage us today, if you want to have good words coming out, you've got to put aside certain things in your life. There's an old saying in terminology of the computer, garbage in, garbage out. And we got to, if we're going to put garbage in, garbage is going to come out. And so we have to learn how to clean our hearts, prepare our hearts for what God wants to do through us. So how do I do this? How do I make this happen in my life? How do I allow my life to become pleasing to God in a way that I can get my heart right? And so we need to look at, how do I get my heart in alignment with God? What do I do? James chapter 3, verses 7 through 8 says, all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is restless evil, full of deadly poison. So here James makes it very clear that you can tame animals, wild animals, but you cannot tame that little tongue. That's impossible that a man tame the tongue. So what does that mean to me and to you today? That means that we need God to help us control our tongue. We need to ask God, who created our tongue, to help us to control and tame our tongue. Number one, allow God to transform your heart, okay? Because the issue is not the tongue, the issue is the heart. So we got to get to the root of the root cause of this problem that we have, and we get to the heart of the matter. So here, in the Bible, it talks about how we got to know God, and we need to have a relationship with God. And when we start to know God, and he said he will write his law on our minds and in our hearts. He becomes our God, and we become his people, and we start to live by the law of God, and we have these boundaries in our life. Then we start to understand God, and then we start to ask God, and we need to ask God every day, God, forgive me. God created me a clean heart. You know, when you ask God to forgive you, you're asking him to forgive you of what you did wrong, but also of what others did against you, that you not hold a grudge against them. You not hold that hatred and that bitterness against them. Because when we let those things in our heart, it will affect the way that we see and the way that we talk. I've been there before where I was bitter and I didn't like certain things that people did. And if I wasn't careful, I would let my speech come forth with that bitterness from my heart. And I don't want that to be. And God said we've got to know God and write his word on our heart so that we can be clean from this. And then we ask God. We need to ask God to give us discernment. Ask God to help us to discern right from wrong, what is good in our life from what is better in our life. Because, you can do good things, but God has better things. And it's important that we discern these things and that we put ourselves in the right places with the right people. Ask God to help you to make the right friends and to create the right relationships in your life. God will help you with these areas of your life. And then ask God to give you new desires. Ask him to put new desires in your heart. The desires that you have from your past, God wants to put new desires. The Bible says he wants to create in you a new heart. In other words, he is a creator. He can make something from nothing. And what seems like is impossible to God, the creator, is not impossible. And then also, let's make a declaration of dependence upon God and then surrender our will to him daily. God, I surrender to you and to your will for my life so that I can put a guard around my tongue. I'm not just speaking words of that are not helpful, but I'm speaking words of life because my heart's right. I make a declaration of dependence upon God. I don't want to be independent from God. I want to be dependent upon God. Psalms 19 verse 14 says, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. I want to meditate and I want my words to be connected to what I meditate on. See, that's what's going to happen when you speak words. It's going to be based upon the words that you meditate on. What are you watching? What are you listening to? What are you allowing in? Because it's those things that are going to influence the words that you speak. And then number two, be careful what I allow in my heart. guard your heart. Proverbs 14:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from your heart. Everything comes from the heart. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. Everything flows from your heart. And then number three, choose to speak life-giving words. Choose to speak life-giving words. Words of affection. You know, Jesus, when he went to be baptized of John the Baptist while he was in the water, God spoke from a voice from heaven. And this is what he said. He said, this is my son, whom I love. With him, I am well pleased. And, you know, it's important that our children hear us say that we love them. It's important that our children hear us say we're pleased with them or we're proud of them, because this is what they need to hear. God exampled this to the life of Jesus and to for us to see that we should love and show words, speak words of affection towards those in our life, and not just our family members, but even friends, people that are close to us, that we would be able to show and speak words of love to them, words of affection. And then the thing that we need to do is words of praise. Words of praise and encouragement. Here's another passage in Ephesians 4:29. It says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. So only speak words that encourage and build up. Don't speak words that degrade and pull down, but speak words that build up and build up other people. Because when you build up other people, you yourself are going to go up. And some people think that when I tear people down, that I can step on them and go to the top. But that's not how God's work. That's not how God works. And that's not how anything works. You will reap what you sow. If you discourage and you are speaking unwholesome words to people, you yourself will experience that in your own life. And so I want to be a person that builds up, encourages, and praises other people. And then another word that we need to speak, the words that we need to speak, is words of healing. Proverbs 15:4 says, the tongue that brings healing is a tree of life. When you speak words of healing, it's like the tree of life. It brings you to a place where you have a refreshing in your heart. Your heart is refreshed and made new again. And I want to encourage you today to be a person that brings healing to those who are broken around you. And then another word, speak words of faith. Speak words. This is probably one of the most important aspects, because it kind of covers some of all of this. Speak words of faith. What does that mean? Here's this passage in Romans 4, verse 17. It says, Abraham is our father in the sight of God in whom he believed. That the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. So God called things out of Abraham. God called Abraham to go somewhere, but he called him out and he changed his name. God calls things out of us. God calls things out of us. See, what we have to learn how to do is, instead of seeing the evidence around us and all the negativity and the problems and focusing on that, we need to see and believe that God is doing something better behind the scenes. We need to believe that God is doing something good in our family. We need to believe that God is doing something good in our children when we don't even see it. And we need to call it out of them before we actually see it in the physical. We need to call it out in the spiritual and say, this is what I see, and encourage them to a point where they believe and they themselves start to see with spiritual eyes that God is doing something good in their life. One day I remember when I was getting, the pastor had asked me to speak, and I was feeling a call into the ministry. And as a young man, he encouraged me to speak before the church. And it was like a pre-service message before the actual pastor was going to get up and speak. And he allowed me about 10 minutes to speak. And I'll never forget preparing and how nervous I was. And I got up to speak. And when I got up to speak, I just felt like I just flubbed. I felt like everything fell apart. I forgot everything that I was supposed to say. And I turned red and all different shades. And was very, very shy back then. And I got down off of the platform and went to my seat. And after the service was over, this lady named Janice Murphy, she walked up to me, very sweet lady, very loving lady, gentle. And she walked up to me and she said, Tony, she said, that was a wonderful message. She said, you know what I did? I put that message in my Bible. She wrote it in the front of her Bible and she said, I've got this here, your very first sermon, and this is a wonderful message. It spoke to my heart. And when I heard her say that at first, I felt like, man, I don't know what you were listening to, because I felt like it was a total failure. But she encouraged me to such a degree that it was just, it was amazing. It helped me. Even though I knew it was not what I wanted it to be, she helped me because she said she got something from that. And I just want to tell you today, there's something powerful when that happens. When you become life, a life-giving person, when you give life to people, it helps you just as much as it helps them, but it helps them too. And so let's be that kind of people. Let's be people that wherever we go, we're life-giving, we're showing, we're encouraging, we're speaking faith, not what we see, but we're speaking what we know is going to happen. And this is what we have to do. But we cannot do that with ourselves in our own power. We have to do it with God's power. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength, and therefore I will speak words of life. Today, I just encourage you to let this word get in your hearts, and let's live by this, and let's walk in this, and let's let God take us to new heights in our relationship with Him. I wonder if we could just bow our heads and pray. Today, if you have not given your life to Jesus, He is here today to fill you, to satisfy your deepest desires in your life. God wants to give you the Holy Spirit. He wants to give you His Spirit that can give you the hope and the faith to go forward in every area of your life. And let's just bow our heads and pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you that it has power to bring life. It has power to transform our hearts. And God, today I surrender my heart to you. I give my life to you. God, forgive me of my sins. Create in me a clean heart. And God, help me to discern what is right in my life so that I can do and make the right choices. God, I give my heart and my life to you, that I'll never be the same again. God, I need a fresh start, and I receive that, and I believe this word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, I just want to congratulate you for praying that and encourage you to move forward in your faith and your relationship with God. This is a journey. This is not a sprint. This is a marathon, and we got to keep moving forward in our faith. And if you have not been a part of our church, I encourage you to join us on our Zoom calls on Wednesday. We will be having these. We do sermon discussions, and we get people involved in connecting with one another. Also, we will be continuing our services right here on Sunday, and we also have another class called Growth Track, where you can learn about your spiritual journey and how to grow in God and how to make your next steps. Send us a message on Facebook. Let us know that you watch. Let us know that you, maybe if you gave your life to God, let us know that. We'd love to hear that and hear from you. God bless you today. Every week we give you an opportunity to give, because we believe that giving is a way in which we move our faith forward in God. And I just want to say thank you to every person. Maybe I know there's some people that give online that we don't even know who you are, but I just want to say thank you. And more than anything, it's just exciting to see you growing in your faith as you learn how to give and share what God has given you. And because we know that every good gift comes down from the Father. So why don't we just pray and ask God to bless this offering and bless each and every one of you today. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you, God, for this opportunity to give. We pray you will bless this offering. Lord, bless every person that can give today. And let the word of this that we've received today get deep in our hearts so that we can become even more generous in our giving and more generous in every area of our life in the words that we speak. We love you today, and we thank you for all that you're doing. We give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us. And today we're going to just continue in this next song, and let's worship together. God bless.
Let the key of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the key. You are good, good.
We are so happy that you joined us here today on Facebook Live, and we hope to see you next week.